so who is ready for their last week of summer vacation before they go back to school?
Me!
All the parents are ready for school, except for the teachers. All the parents are ready for summer to be over. Homeschool, you guys just be quiet. You guys don't have real lives anyway, so no big deal. Look at that, Josh got a chair even, so that's good. All right, so this is week 4 of You Asked For It. As you can see, we have one screen that's not cooperating tonight, so you guys will all get to look over on this screen. So good for you guys, good vision check for you. Maybe cover one eye each time and see if you can still see the villains. If not, tell your parents. You guys probably just have a sore neck by the end of the night, but you'll get over it. So tonight is week 4 of You Asked For It. And as we're going through all the questions that you guys turned in, one of the things we did is we tried to group them into like topics so they kind of fit together. And so we had a lot of questions about kind of growing in your faith. So tonight, all 4 questions that we're going to be going over are all really about growing in your faith. How do you do that? So let's get started with the first question. Question number 1. Does God always forgive me if I keep sinning? If I keep sinning, does God always forgive me if I keep sinning? Even if I say I'll never do them again. And this question didn't really surprise me. This is a pretty common question both for adults and students. And it's because, I think I talked about 2 weeks ago, we're kind of just a sinful creature all on our own anyway. And so we're always going to struggle with sin. And so that's something that we just continue to deal with, is that we just keep sinning, unfortunately, just because that's unfortunately how we are. But 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from unrighteousness. So what that says is that as long as we continue to confess our sins, he will continue to forgive our sins. But one thing I find is that a lot of times we continue to ask forgiveness for the same sin over and over. Maybe we're not repeating the sin, but we just can't get past that sin. So we just keep asking for forgiveness every week, it seems like, or every time we pray for forgiveness for that same sin. And what we need to realize is that God has forgiven us the very first time we ask for forgiveness. We need to forgive ourselves. And usually that's the hardest part, is for us to get past the sin, not for God. He's already moved on and he's forgiven you, and you're on, got a clean slate ready to go. But a lot of times we have a hard time letting stuff go. And I talk to students all the time that seem to be struggling with something, and then I talk to them a month later and they're still struggling with it. I'm like, I thought we talked about that. I thought we talked about how you've already asked forgiveness for that. You're not sinning again, but for some reason you just keep asking for forgiveness. And so it seems to be something we struggle with, and I definitely struggle with it myself. So it's definitely just human nature that we're going to sin, right? I mean, we're just sinful creatures. So anyone here struggle with kind of the same sin over and over and over? Anybody? Nope. Good, good. Few truth tellers in the audience, that's good. So there's one sin that I probably struggle with more than anything, and it seems to be a repetitive one, and it drives me crazy because I think I'm getting so good at it and not doing it, but then all of a sudden it just pops up, and that's cussing. For some reason, I was kind of raised in a household where everybody cussed, and then as I came to church 8 years ago or so, I realized that I shouldn't talk like that anymore. But I already had a lot of four-letter words in my vocabulary, so trying to unlearn to use those words on a regular basis has been really difficult. But it's one of those things where I think I'm doing so good, and I pray about it, and I'm always asking God for help on it, and I just continue to work at it, but for some reason it just pops up. The next thing I know, I cussed at somebody, or I cussed at something, or somebody pulled out in front of me and I say something I shouldn't say. And it's just one of those things I just continue to struggle with. And I tell you that because I want you to know it's okay that you do struggle with the sin. People struggle with sins, and there's things in your life that you are always going to have to struggle with and always going to have to work on, because it's just that thing that's just going to get at you. And so realize that. Don't tear yourself down every time you maybe fall back into that. Just ask for forgiveness and keep praying for God's help in removing that from your life, and it'll definitely help. But that's one that definitely bothers me. So I think Daniel, the verse Daniel 9:9 is a good verse to remember when you continue to struggle with the same sin over and over. And it says, "The Lord our God is merciful and forgiving, even though we have rebelled against him." And so that's one of those ones where, you know, it's just saying, you know, God is merciful, forgiving, and rebel. I mean, that's kind of what you're doing if you keep sinning over and over and over, is you're kind of rebelling against what he wants out of your life. And so just know that he continues to love you and is forgiving you even though you continue to rebel against him. So question number two that you guys asked and we want to answer tonight is, how can God help me through heartbreak and sadness in my family? And Psalms 34:18 says, "The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit." And that's really just to say that, you know, God's with you, especially during the bad times, especially during those times that you feel so terrible. That's when he draws closest to you. And I think a lot of times people feel like during those bad times when things are kind of dark and things aren't going well with your family, or there's a problem with a loved one, or there's sickness, or there's death, you feel like God's so far away. And usually it's because you've distanced yourself from God, not that he's distanced himself from you. He's drawing close to you when you need him, but for some reason, we as humans have a tendency to kind of push ourselves away from God and then go, "God's so far away from me," but really it's the fact that we've pushed ourselves away from him. So remember that during those bad times when you need to focus on clinging to God the most, and that's really important to make sure you do during those bad times. And I'm going to throw the booth in for a loop, but it's really the second point, not the third point, so be aware. So Rick Warren had this quote that I found, and I thought it was so good, and it says, and if you guys don't know who Rick Warren is, Google him. He runs this awesome church called Saddleback in California, and they have approximately 1.3 billion people that go to the church, I think. I don't know. There's a lot. So he's written a couple million books, and he's a pretty awesome guy. So he had this great quote that says, "Your most profound and intimate experiences of worship will likely be in your darkest days, when your heart is broken and when you feel abandoned. When you're out of options, when the pain is great, you turn to God alone." And I think that's really important to realize that a lot of times, you know, during worship, I'll see a student start to tear up or something, and I realize it's because something's bothering them right then. And all of a sudden, for some reason, that worship song just clicks with them and makes them kind of release and understand that God's there with them. And that's really just the Holy Spirit kind of working on you during that worship song. So 2 weeks ago when I spoke, I talked about that music really affects my attitude. And I talked about the difference between listening to Hillsong and Eminem. And for some reason, my attitude's different when I listen to those two different types of music. And for me, when I'm feeling kind of distant from God, a lot of times music will help draw me back in. And so if I feel like I'm just not connecting and just am not feeling, you know, very Christian-like, for some reason a good worship song will really kind of draw me back in. And so there's this one song that I listen to quite often, and I don't even know how many times I've listened to it, but it's really just a song that helps me just kind of connect with God and realize I'm with him and that he's with me. And so I wanted you guys to kind of listen to some of that song tonight. So I'm going to go ahead and ask them to start that video. Thank you. All right. So those of you that know that song know there's still a couple more minutes there, but I didn't want to take up the entire night playing the video. So the reason I wanted to show you that song is that that song is, like I said, that affects me, and it makes me realize that, you know, God's close to me and helps me just kind of reel back in with God. I know there's a lot of people here that are touched by music, and music works in their lives a lot, so it doesn't need to be this song, but if there's a song out there that you listen to and you just, for some reason, just it kind of clicks with you and you can kind of get in the moment, embrace that and realize that's that song for you and that you can use that when you need it. It's just kind of a time to tune back in with God, especially if it's a time of hurt. You just need to put it on repeat and just let it play over and over and over again. If that's what you need to feel connected to God, use a song like Everything to help reel you back in. So, next question you guys asked, number three, what should I read in the Bible? How do I know? What should I read in the Bible? How do I know? Well, you know what the really cool thing about reading the Bible is? It doesn't matter what you read. Any of it is good. Because what I found is that when I read the Bible, God reveals cool things to me no matter what chapter or verse I'm reading. So even if I've read it like 3 or 4 times or 100 times, I've read the gospel more times, you know, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, more times than I can count. Every time I read it, God reveals something different to me. So don't worry so much about exactly what should I read in the Bible. Should I read New Testament? Should I read Old Testament? Just pick it up and start reading. God will show you where you need to read and reveal things to you no matter what verse and chapter you're reading. So the best thing you can do is start reading. But if you're still kind of struggling with, you know, well, I just need some structure. I need to know what to read tonight. And, you know, I read this chapter, but now I don't know what to read next. Or, you know, restarting at the Old Testament in Genesis is painful. Yes, it is. Because by the time you get to Numbers, you're just ready to die. And so, you know, don't just try to say, I'm going to start with Genesis and read the Bible straight through. You probably, it's going to be very tough to do. Some of you can probably do it, but most people will struggle trying to do that. So what we have here at church is we have a thing called the 2020 Bible Reading Plan. Those of you that are at church this morning, Pastor Jeff also talked about this. And the idea is that you read 20 minutes a day for 20 days a month. So that, as you guys know, there's 30 to 31 days usually in a month. So that's not even reading the Bible every day. That's just like 4 or 5 days a week you read the Bible. So you can screw up and not read the Bible a couple days. It's okay. Just start back again when you mess up, and you know, you get a couple of free days, so if you don't like reading on the weekend or you have a lot of homework. So what the 2020 Bible Plan does is allow you to really read through a ton of stuff and really kind of understand, you know, gives you a good plan to start. And what I found when I started reading this is that it's not even 20 minutes. Some of them are like 10 minutes. It's really fast and easy. So if you need some structure on what to read, we're going to hand these out at the door as you guys leave tonight, so you can kind of follow along and have a good structured plan to read along. And I know we did this about a year or so ago, and it was cool because all of a sudden people were posting on Facebook the stuff they were reading, or they were texting each other and kind of doing group texts to talk about the stuff they were reading that night. And everybody was kind of together, right? Because everybody's on the same week or the same month. And so it made it for a lot of fun for the entire group because everybody was kind of reading the same stuff, so they kind of feed off of each other. So if you guys want to start this, or find 3 or 4 friends and go, hey, let's try and read through this together, I challenge you to do that. Try and stick together. Find a friend that you can read with, and that'll help you stay on task and have some accountability for reading. But the biggest thing is just read. Just read the Bible. Don't worry about exactly what you're reading. Don't worry about exactly the Old Testament, New Testament. Just read it. I will say, you know, New Testament, lots of Jesus. Old Testament, lots of crazy stuff going on, right? I found out Isaac was a total pimp the other night when I was reading. I mean, there is all sorts of stuff, you know, guys, you know, having sex with like 18 women in a row, all of a sudden they got flocks of sons out there. I'm like, wow, that's in the Bible, right? And so there's just all this crazy stuff in there. So a little bit of everything going out there for stories. So just find something you like. In Psalms 119, 105, the verse says, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. And that's really just saying, if you read the Bible, it's going to open your eyes and reveal to you the things God needs you to see as you're going through life. So just pick it up and start reading, and you will be just fine. Question number 4. How do I know what to pray about? how do I know what to pray about? And Matthew 6:6 says, when you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And that's really just to say, the quiet time that you spend with God by yourself and praying is way more important than the praying you do in front of a group here or at dinner with your parents. It's that quiet time behind closed doors when it's just you and God. That's the most important part of the prayer. And so realize that quiet time, that quiet prayer is really important. And for what to pray about, you know what? Just pray about whatever's on your mind. Just whatever's on your heart, whatever you're struggling with, whatever you're happy about. He wants to hear what you're happy about, what you're sad about. He just wants to be part of your life. So just pray about anything that's on your heart and on your mind, and God will be open to that. There's a verse out there called the Lord's Prayer. Has anybody heard the Lord's Prayer before? Raise your hand if you've heard the Lord's Prayer. The Lord's Prayer has been repeated for, I'm sure, thousands of years now. And a lot of people think this is the prayer. Like, when you're ready to pray to God, you just recite the Lord's Prayer, and then you just pray to God. But I don't really think of that as really a prayer. And so what I want to do is really read the Lord's Prayer and then kind of break it down for you a little bit. So it says, the Lord's Prayer, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. So some people will hear that and go, okay, I'm just going to recite that, and that's my prayer for tonight. I'm good. But did you really kind of tell God anything about yourself? Have you really revealed anything about yourself? So what I want to do is kind of break this down a little bit. And the first part to remember is the Lord's Prayer is a pattern. It's kind of breaking down, you know, what you should be praying about. It's not a chant. It's not like something you need to, you know, chant in complete repetition every time. And so Jesus said this is how, not what, you should pray. And so Jesus gave it as a pattern to his followers, and it's not something you're supposed to recite. So the first part says, our Father in heaven. So that's really just about recognizing that God is who God is, that he's almighty. And at the same time, realizing that we're kind of like a child approaching him like a father. It says, hallowed be your name. Hallowed, right? Who uses hallowed in regular speak, right? I mean, you never like walk down the halls and be like, hey, hallowed, what's up, right? Unless you're trying to make, you know, a word happen all of a sudden. It's not going to really happen. So hallowed be your name is really just about saying that God is perfect and that he's different from us. And that's really what hallowed is all about, is that you're recognizing that God is different than us. Then it says, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And that's really the key word there, is your will be done. And for us, that just really means God's desires in our heart will be done. And so that's really just about praying about your desires, praying about what you love and what's exciting to you and all of that. Then it says, give us today our daily bread. And that's really just about God gives us what we need, not maybe everything we want, right? So our daily bread is really just what we need to get by in life. It's not, you know, a 15-course meal we need. It's just what we need to get by every day. And then it says, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And so God is the only person that can forgive sin, but it also reminds us that we need to forgive other people. And we talked about this a couple weeks ago. You know, we need to make sure we're forgiving people when they've sinned against us, and continue to make sure we're smart about, you know, forgiving people. And that's really what this verse is all about. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. And that's really about confessing your sins to God. And it's really important to make sure you do that while you're praying. Talk about what you love. Talk about how great God is. But you also have to talk about the things you're struggling with, right? The things that are there around you, that evil that you feel like you need deliverance against. And then it says, for thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And And it's really just another way of saying, God, I recognize you as so powerful, and just making sure that you continue to recognize that all through that prayer that you're praying to this great Heavenly Father out there that just wants to be good for you. So I tell you all that to just show you that there is no perfect pattern for prayer. There is no specific thing you have to say. Just say whatever's on your heart. That's what God really wants to hear. So don't get caught up in thous and thees and oh greatest Lord and all that. I know I'm talking to some students right here and praying with some of the students here. I hear all sorts of even phrases for God, right? People say daddy and father and Jesus and Lord and whatever you feel comfortable talking and talking to God, use that language. Use those words that you feel comfortable with. It doesn't have to be this big important speech type of thing where it has to be perfect. You can stumble through it. Sometimes it can be five words. God, I need your help. Amen. Right? The next time it can be the 20-minute prayer. Whatever's on your heart, that's what you need to use. So tonight, let's talk about next steps. You pull out your connection card. On the back of that connection card, there's some decisions there. And the first one is, I ask Jesus into my heart tonight. And that's really, if you're asking Jesus into your heart for the first time, if you don't know God and you're saying, I need this relationship, I see all my friends have this relationship, I need that relationship with God, that's the box we need to check tonight if you're asking God into your heart for the first time. The next is, you will commit to the 2020 reading plan. You're going to give this a shot. You're really going to try. You're really going to, you know what? You probably won't get it right every single time. You might miss a couple nights. But you're going to go ahead and give it a shot. You're going to sign up for the 2020 reading plan. And you're going to grab a pamphlet when you leave tonight so you know where to start reading. So you'll be able to follow along. The next one is, I will spend more time talking to God on a daily basis. And that should really be a given, right? Because everybody knows we need to spend more time praying and talking to God. We just don't do it. We just need to spend more time doing that. So if you guys want to check one of those boxes, make sure you fill out your connection card completely. We're going to collect those here in a few minutes after the next worship set. We're going to go ahead now and close out in prayer while the band comes out. So bow your head. God, thank you for tonight, God, that we can just be here and just talk about how to grow in our faith, God, whether it's prayer or reading the Bible or getting through dark times, God. God, thank you for just helping us realize that we need more of you in our life, God, and however we need to get more of you through reading, through praying, through just speaking to you. God, just continue to give us that insight we need, God, so we can draw closer to you and have a better relationship with you, God. God, thank you for what you're doing in this youth group and with these students. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Come on up and worship.